Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory.
Right, thank you to our reader, well read. Right, does anyone recognise those chaps?
Yeah.
Yeah, everyone, you know which one's which? So you've got Alistair on the left, you've got Johnny on the right, and they're racing there, a race in Mexico, Cozumel, Mexico. And I thought I'd just read a report from BYU, I think it's a university, on this event. So this is in Cozumel. In Cozumel, when the competitors neared the end of the grueling nearly two-hour race, Johnny Brownlee held a comfortable lead, that's the guy on the right, with his Alistair, his brother, trailing him, and Henry Schumann from South Africa close behind. So at that stage, Johnny was first, Alistair was second, and then this South African guy, Henry, was third. Video footage of the race shows that with nearly 500 meters to go, just as Johnny rounded a corner, the heat took its toll on his body. Johnny's pace slowed to a stumble, and he collapsed onto a volunteer standing by the sidelines. When Alistair came around the corner, he saw his dangerously dehydrated younger brother unable to finish the race. Without hesitation, Alistair ran toward Johnny, threw his dazed brother's arm around his neck, and half carried him as they ran the last 500 meters side by side. So that's them doing that there. Alistair's deviation cost him a chance at the grand prize, allowing Schumann to win the race. As the brothers approached the finish line, Alistair pushed Johnny across the line ahead of him, giving Johnny second place and himself third. Alistair was a half a kilometre from winning gold and becoming the world champion, yet rather than claim victory for himself, he slowed, picked up his brother, and enabled Johnny to do something he could not do for himself, finish the race. And then my words, so there was a limit to what Johnny could do himself. He got to a certain place but couldn't get across the line. Something had to happen to get him there. And by the way, apparently when a reporter asked Johnny, asked Alistair, after the race, why he didn't just leave Johnny there and go and win the race himself, he said, oh, Mum wouldn't have been happy with that, which I thought was quite funny. So Psalm 24 is a beautiful psalm. And if you go to the next slide, Poppy, if you wouldn't mind. Got it on screen there. So I'll read it just briefly again. Do follow, if you've got Bibles, do follow it along. So, of David, a psalm. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. And then if you go to the next one, Poppy. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. Okay, and if you go one more, thank you. Right, so the key question that the psalm poses is there in verse 3, and hopefully you can see that in your Bibles and it's on screen as well. So the question is, who may ascend the mountain of the Lord and who may stand in his holy place? So that's two questions. I know it's two questions, but it's really fundamentally asking the same question. So the first one is, who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may go up the mountain of the Lord? And there are a few examples of people who go up a mountain in the Bible. Moses is an example. Moses goes up the mountain several times. And when he goes up, there's a cloud that envelops the mountain. His face becomes radiant after he speaks with God. God speaks to him. And so the point when he's going up the mountain is he goes up to be in the presence of God. He goes up to meet with God. Second question asks the same thing. And as I say, it's a very similar thing. So who may stand in his holy place? So if you compare that with the start of Psalm 15, what it's likely talking about is the most holy place in the tabernacle, which was somewhere only the high priest was allowed to go. So there on the right-hand side, you can see kind of a representation of that. You can see there's a curtain there which prevents people from going in. Only the high priest is allowed to go in there. You can see it's got purple, scarlet, blue, and it's got cherubim on the outside as well, which is significant as well. But again, the point is that God dwelt there. God was there, and the high priest was allowed to go in. So who may dwell in his presence? Who may go up the mountain to be in the presence of the Lord? Who may go into the most holy place to be in the presence of the Lord? That's the point. And so the rest of the psalm then answers that question. And it answers it in two parts. So firstly, verses 4 to 6. So verses 4 to 6 say, "The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god, they will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob." So that's basically saying that the one who does right is the one who can go up the mountain and be in the presence of the Lord, who can go and be in the presence of the Lord. The one who does right, the one who has clean hands, the one who has a pure heart, can go and be in the presence of the Lord. But as Christians, we know, don't we, that we don't always have clean hands. We don't always do what is right. We don't always have a pure heart. So this creates a bit of a problem because we don't always do those things. So if it is the one who has clean hands and a pure heart who can ascend and go and stand in the presence of God, who is it? How can we stand? How do we ever have a hope of being in the presence of God? And this is not a New Testament problem. This is not just what we think now and what they didn't think then. In the Old Testament, remember we talked about Moses going up the mountain of the God to go and be in the presence. When he did that, God set limits for the people around the mountain. So the people weren't allowed to go up. Moses was allowed to go up, but the people had to stand at the bottom of the mountain. They weren't allowed to go up. And so Moses had to go and mediate for the people. He had to go and be their representative. Or take the most holy place, the one on the right-hand side there. So again, only the high priest was allowed to go in, and then only on the Day of Atonement, only on that special day, was the high priest allowed to go in. So again, the high priest went in and was the mediator, was the representative for the people. No one else was allowed to go in, no one was allowed to go past that curtain. So who is it then who will mediate for us, who can go into the very presence of God and act as our representative? So Moses and the high priest did it in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. Who can do it for us? Well, let's get back to the psalm. So from verse 7, "Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in." Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. "Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in." Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. So this one, this King of glory, is someone who can enter the presence of God and act as our mediator. So he can mediate for us. He can be in God's presence. He is a king, yet somehow he's also identified as God. So if you look in verses 8 and 10, identifying him as God. So who is this mediator? Who is this King of Glory? You will probably guess what I'm going to say, which is Jesus. But there is a time in the New Testament when Jesus does exactly the same thing. He goes up a mountain, the cloud covers the mountain, his face becomes radiant, and God speaks with him, and that is at the Transfiguration. So he goes up a mountain, and all very similar things happen to what Moses did in the Old Testament. And there are some differences, a couple of differences between the two accounts, but one key difference for our purposes is that Moses went up, at least to the very top of the mountain, on his own, right? So he went on his own to be in the presence of God. Jesus takes his disciples, or at least some of them, right? So in the Old Testament, there were limits set for the people. If you remember, there's limits around the mountain. Most of them weren't even allowed to touch the foot of the mountain. Some were allowed to go a little way up, but most weren't even allowed to touch the foot of the mountain. But Jesus takes his disciples up. And then when Jesus died, that temple curtain on the right-hand side there was ripped. The thing that prevented people from entering the presence of God was ripped top to bottom. That's an extraordinarily hard thing to do. The whole thing comes apart, and the way to God's presence is made open. So now, and this is the key point, he has made a way for us to be in the presence of God. So he's made a way for us to be in the presence of God. So we don't need to go up a mountain to go and be in the presence of God to worship. We don't need to be in a temple. The way has been made open for us to go and be in the presence of God. Now there's still a sense in which we're yet to kind of see him as he is, but we've been given the Holy Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing our inheritance. So we have the Holy Spirit. We can worship God in spirit and in truth. So we don't have to do these things. We have his presence now without going up a mountain and without being in a temple. What a privilege that is. So to go back to the psalm briefly then. So verses 7 and 9. The ancient doors and the gates are encouraged to let the King of Glory in. So that's my question for us as well. So do we let the King of Glory in? How do we do that? Jesus says, when he says, I'm standing at the door knocking, do we let him in? Now that's a fair question, but a fair question back might be, well, that's pretty abstract, isn't it? How do we let him in? So Jesus promises in John that God will make his home with those who love him. So it's John 14:23. God will make his home with those who love him. And then so the question is, then how do we love him? Because if you ask a Christian child, and I'm always amazed at this, you ask a Christian child, do you love God? They will just like that go, yes, of course I love God. I love God. As if it's the easiest thing in the world. I love God. It's incredible. But for those of us like me who have forgotten how to be children, it's helpful to have a think about how we love God. So Poppy, would you mind going to the next slide? So does anyone know what that is? There's a couple of clues there. It's a tricky, tricky picture. Does anyone know? Yes, well done. It is the California Gold Rush. Now, I don't know much about it. Apparently, it happened between 1848, 1855, beginning on January 24th, 1848, when gold was found by James W. Marshall at Sutter's Mill in Coloma, California. When it was heard that gold was in California, it brought approximately 300,000 people there from the rest of the United States and beyond. And then, Poppy, sorry, one more. I think that's it now. No more clicking you have to do. So that reminded me of something that Jesus said in Matthew. So where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So again, Jesus promises that God will make his home with anyone who loves him. And where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Okay? So our heart follows what we treasure. If we treasure gold, our heart will go after gold. If we treasure cricket, our heart will go after cricket. These aren't, things aren't bad, but that's how it works. And if we treasure the gospel, our heart will go after God. So if we are to let the King of Glory in, like that psalm encourages, the best way is to understand and treasure what he's done for us. Now, we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing, but in this in particular, it is important for us to understand and treasure the gospel if we're to let him in. So first of all, the recognizing the sin and the gravity of our sin, our own sin. I sin, you sin, we all sin. It's not a nice thing to talk about, but without grace, we are lost and spiritually dead. And I don't know about you, but as I get older, I become more conscious of it. I become more conscious of what I think, of what I say, my pride, these things, they are with me. And maybe you're the same. Maybe you even feel guilt. Maybe you even feel shame about what you think, what you do. And that's why the gospel is such good news, because it's something to treasure, that God deals with our sins by Jesus' death and resurrection. He nails them to the cross. We aren't accountable for them anymore. So we are free. So a guy called Horatio Spafford, in his famous hymn, puts it much better than I can. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. And then my favorite verse, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, everything, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. And I know that this is kind of Christianity 101 for most people, and I don't want to teach you suck eggs. I do think it's a useful reminder. We're talking about letting the King of Glory in. I do think it's a useful reminder to show us how we love God. So if you are struggling to love God, if you're struggling to let the King of Glory in, then do have a think about the gospel and be encouraged that he is faithful. And if you haven't ever heard the gospel, if you don't believe that God could do that for you, if you don't understand it, have a think about, if you don't mind having a think about speaking with one of our leaders, Al, Tim, or Gordon. I hope you don't mind me just giving your time away, but have a think about that. And I also, it's also likely there are some people here who probably having tough times, and relationship with God is difficult, and that's really difficult. And in one sense, I don't know what to say. I know I've had difficult times, and probably will do again. I've really struggled, and will likely do again. And I know it's stupid, but the way I thought of it, probably because I wasn't close with God at the time, the way I thought of it, it's a weird thing. I had this picture, this is how I thought of it. I had this heavy weight that I was holding above my head like this. It was really heavy, and I was trying to do the right thing, and I was trying to do everything, and someone was punching me in the stomach. It's just how it felt. So the only thing I'd say if you're in that situation is it doesn't have to be all smiles when you're in the presence of God. So Jesus wept when he heard of Lazarus's death. He describes God as our comforter, and he can also restore us. So my encouragement would be to bring it to God. You can weep in God's presence. It's fine. Just weep in God's presence is absolutely fine. Maybe find a trusted Christian friend or something, but please don't give up. Please come back to God. Keep coming back to God. And then for some people, your heart might be utterly on fire for God, and you might feel close to him and in his presence, and your heart might leap when you hear the gospel. My encouragement to you would be accept by faith the freedom that comes with that. Enjoy it. And just make sure you're worshipping in truth the God of the Bible. You're worshipping the God of the Bible. and that your heart is right with God, but enjoy it. And then for everyone, don't worry too much about how you express being in the presence of God, your worship of God, these things. You don't need to dance and you don't need to be still. You don't need to raise your hands. You don't need to keep them down. You don't need to wave flags and you don't need to stay in your seats. I'm sure as long as they're, well, within the realms of order and peace of within the church, I'm sure Al doesn't mind how we express our love for God. So David leapt and he danced before God, and Hannah poured out her soul quietly. She wasn't even speaking, her lips were moving. One was expressive and one was quiet. Both were judged by people, and God vindicated both of them. Because people look at the outward appearance and God looks at the heart. So if you love God within the realms of church order and peace, feel free to express it. And then importantly, there's no hierarchy. God's love and your ability to love him, to be in his presence, is not dependent on being a church leader, a worship leader, a speaker, a youth leader, whatever. It just is not. Remember, God looks at the heart, not the outward appearance. He's revealed these things to little children, and he has hidden them from the wise and the learned. So if you're thinking, what, even me? Then especially you. Because God says, I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. So if you treasure the gospel, if you love God, do turn your heart to him and let the King of Glory in. And lift up your heads, you gates, be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is he, this King of Glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of Glory. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for saving us and all you have done for us. Please help us to understand and accept the gospel. Help us to let the King of Glory in. Thank you for so much for everything you've done for us, Lord. Amen.